Very good afternoon to everyone. Before starting with my presentation, as a forensic person, I will say that whatever comes to us as a forensic people, we believe that the evidence and the facts, they are the most important thing, whatever we come across and encounter in our day-to-day life. The facts and the evidence plays a major role. And also they play a very important role in crime investigation. And without that, whatever we are doing, discussing anything is just a guessing game. So the evidence are the most important thing, and the evidence are the things which actually matters for us. So today my topic for presentation is the emerging trends in the multimedia forensics. I will say that multimedia itself is an emerging field of forensic science, because the multimedia, the audio, video, and image authentications, enhancement, and the analysis part is still a very emerging field in the forensic, and it still requires a lot of development and research in that area. So as you know that we have a variety of crime in this world. Worldwide, we are facing so many cases, like I think Dr. Harsh Sharma sir has majorly covered most of the topics related to the arson, maybe the homicide cases, suicidal cases, wildlife. I was seeing is the case of wildlife forensic also. So all these crimes which are, there are the group of crimes which are being encountered by the forensic people in the day-to-day life. And I would say that as a forensic person, we are taught that anything, whenever there is a contact between any two things, there will be a transfer of material between the two. That is the basic principle of exchange given by Mr. Edmund Locard. I say that now the crime is a little bit changing its shape from the traditional crimes where there is a proper crime scene and the criminal visit a crime scene, commit a crime over there, and then come back and leaving some material over there and taking some material from that crime scene, which forms the basis of investigation, or forms the basis of identification of the two. Or but nowadays the crime has been shifted from the traditional crimes to the more technology based crime, where the criminal does not take an aid of any physical weapon or something and go to, and there is no need of going to a particular crime scene and committing the crime. They can sit at any place of the world or at any place, maybe at their home or some any other safe areas, and can commit the crime with the advancement of technology, thanks to the technology which is available to us. So there is, in these cases, there is no immediate crime scene because the person is not physically present at the scene. But yes, we say that there will be definitely some of the digital fingerprints which will be left by the weapons which they are using for committing such kind of crimes. Although the weapons are not the physical one, these are the digital weapons, but these digital weapons also, like the physical weapons, leave their fingerprint at that place, and that forms the basis of identification in such kind of technology-based crimes. So my topic of multimedia forensic is basically depending upon the how technology can be useful in prevention and detection of crime. So the multimedia and computer forensic, every time it comes in contact with one another, or they are found to be more superimposing or overlapping with one another. But there is a very minor difference or a thin difference of line. They both are the branch of digital forensic. They both comes under the digital forensics, but there is a minor difference between the two. In computer forensics, we basically deals with the cases of extracting the data or the evidences from the digital devices. While in cases of multimedia forensics, whatever information has been extracted by the computer forensic expert, those information or data needs to be identified or needs to be analyzed. And their digital fingerprints are to be detected so that we can link those data with their source. Basically, the main aim of the multimedia forensic is to identify the source or the origin of the data which is being transferred among the people and which can be used as evidence against a particular matter in a court of law. So you might have seen many in many cases in our day-to-day life, we are getting so many WhatsApp messages. Recently, we are dealing with the case which is there in Delhi about the farmers' protest. So there are n number of videos, n number of audios which are being shared on the social media platforms. And they are being originated from one place to another and being transferred through a chain or a thread of information from one body to the another body. But the most important thing which the investigation wants is what is the source or from where these kind of data are being generated and how they are being transmitted from one place to another. So in these cases, the multimedia or the networking forensic will be helpful in identification of the source of the things or the data which are being emerging. This is an example which I have kept. I think most of us can relate with this example. This is an example taken from a very famous movie, and I think everybody might have seen this movie. In this movie, because it was just for the fun or just for the entertainment purpose, some person takes the identity of someone else and may take or may use the mobile phone or the landline phones, create the identity or take the identity of another person and can interact in the name of some another person. But in cases, in our multimedia forensic cases, the question arises, the question which are mostly being frequently asked by the expert is whether actually the person whom the person is claiming to be, he is speaking or maybe somebody else has taken the identity of that person and he is speaking in that particular matter or at that particular scenario. So the voice examinations, maybe sometime it is in the form of the audio where the audio authentications or the examination needs to be done. Sometime I may have taken somebody else's photo and posted it in the name of Surbhi Mathur. So whether the photo which is circulating on the media platforms, whether it actually belongs to Surbhi Mathur or whether it is from the authentic source or not, that also is being covered under the area of multimedia forensics. This is just for your guessing game. These are the cases which are most frequently encountered in our forensic labs, where the photos are being morphed, or maybe the photo of two different people, they are being overlapped or superimposed or mixed with one another. And the question is being asked whether this photo is authentic photo or maybe there is some type of manipulations being done in the photo. As you can see in this picture, this picture is comprised of the photographs of the two very famous actresses. If it was a physical lecture, I might have asked you about the two actresses. But here I will tell you that it is a picture which has been created by taking one picture. The upside, as you can follow my cursor, the upside is being taken from Katrina Kaif and the downward is being taken from Deepika Padukone. And we have generated this picture just to make you understand what we as a forensic people do. Normally, in cyber and multimedia forensic labs, we receive the cases where the face of some another person is there and the body is of some another person. You can relate with the cases where there is a circulation of the obscene photographs or the naked photographs of the females and the body is of somebody else and the face of a female with the help of the different softwares, the face has been implanted over that particular body. So the need of a multimedia expert at that particular time is very much required to identify the truth behind the picture. So that is also the other most important thing which we people are doing. So why multimedia forensics? I say that why, what is the need of multimedia forensic is the most important thing we as the multimedia people are doing, we are identifying the sources. The source identification, whether the particular media may be in form of audio, video, or image, it has been generated from a particular source or a suspected source or not. It can be a mobile phone. Mobile phones can also have a variety of categories. It can be a Samsung phone of a such particular model. It can be an iPhone of a particular model. It can be any of the Chinese model phone can be there. Or the laptop, PC, or your desktop, from where the photograph have been originated, from where the image has been captured, the source identification needs to be done. Next is of our authenticity analysis. And this is the most frequent cases which we are receiving in the labs. We are being provided with the two pictures, or maybe we are provided with a set of pictures, and we have to find out whether the picture is authentic or not, or is there any type of addition. As you can see in this example, this person has been added in this original picture. Whether there is an addition of somebody or some object in the picture, or if there is a deletion of the object from the picture, or maybe if there is a substitution of some another object from the picture. So that needs to be determined by the multimedia experts. Next is the enhancement and restoration. I can tell you that maximum cases we receive from the CCTV footages. Whenever the crime happened, the CCTV nowadays, because it has been installed in every of the public and the private spaces, plays a major role in providing the very useful information regarding the particular event which has happened. And we have seen that in most of the cases, the footages which we obtain for the analysis are highly degraded, or they are having some type of distortion in that. So whatever footages are being provided to us, the images are being provided to us, if there is a need, we can go for the enhancement and we can restore the image for the better evaluation. Next is the interpretation and the content analysis. Once the source identification, once the authenticity identification is being done, then the interpretation and the content analysis can be done. Whatever is there, whatever is being observed in the pictures, that needs to be analyzed. I remember one case where I will not reveal the case because that is a high confidential case. We received case from the Gujarat government, and there was some objects which were found to be present in the picture, and they asked us whether you find this picture as an authentic one or not, or is there any type of modification being done in the picture. Once the picture was being given the clean sheet that the picture appears to be a genuine picture, there is no kind of modification being done in that, then they asked us for doing the content analysis. Whatever the peoples who are present in that picture needs to be identified through the facial recognition technique. And also there is a very interesting aspect of photogrammetry where the height estimation of the object or of the particular person who is available in the picture, the height estimation needs to be done. That we call it as a science of photogrammetry, that needs to be done. So that is basically being conducted by us, and we are having the different softwares and the techniques for interpreting the data and giving the reports. So condemnation without investigation is the height of ignorance. This has been said by a very well-known scientist, Mr. Albert Einstein. And I also personally believe that without knowing the actual things behind whatever is being provided to you as an evidence, not every time the pictures says the reality, or not, it is not mandatory that every time what you see in a picture or a video is authentic. So without investigation or without establishing the authenticity of the evidence which has been provided to you, just believing it without any scientific proof is a height of ignorance. So the scientific proof needs to be given. This is a case, you might, maybe some of the people will be aware about this case. In 2011, there was a very famous case of Delhi, where a controversial CD came into the market containing the voice samples of three high profile people in that. And through that CD, there was a lot of controversy, a lot of media coverage was being given to this CD because there was a very confidential things which were being out of the CD. And basically, this CD was causing the defamation of the people who were involved in the conversation in that. So one of the person denied that the voice which is present in that CD is not actually mine and it is being implanted from somewhere else and being incorporated in that particular CD. So his claim was the CD is not a genuine CD. The CD is a tempered one which is created according to the need of the people just to defame me or to give a wrong impression about me. Then the CD was being analyzed maybe in this was the longest authenticity analysis which we have seen in the media because this CD went to three different forensic labs or three different forensic organizations. And out of the three, two came out with the opinion that the CD actually had a breaks in that or actually have a different kind of modification factors in that with which the expert came out with the opinion that the CD was not the genuine CD. It was actually the doctored one. And the claim of one of the party which was involved in this CD case, the claim was being proved by the scientific evidence. So that is why it is not always necessary that whatever you listen or whatever you see is found to be a correct thing. You need to analyze it first. Again, my idea of analyzing the things that the evidence don't lie, right? Although in the earlier case, whatever I have shown you, because in this case also there were some evidences which shows that actually there was a modification being done in the exhibits according to the need of the user. Here also, this case was being reported in year 2015. You might have heard about this case. There were a lot of riots and sedition being done in the Gujarat state. And a lot of menace was being created in Gujarat in 2015. And this person whom you are seeing in this photo, he was the major mastermind behind all these riots and the menace which was going on in Gujarat state in 2015. In this case, what happened was there was one tape recording which was being intercepted by the intelligence department. It was being sent to the forensic lab Gandhinagar. Fortunately, I was also the part of the investigation in this. We got the intercepted audio calls from the case which was going on, and there was only three lines which were under suspicion. The three lines were: if they don't accept our demands, pure Gujarat mein aag laga do. This aag laga do were the three words. You see that there were only three words which actually instigated the mass which was present in that rally to set everything on fire in Gujarat state, and it created a lot of public transport or the public loss through the arson or the fire cases were being, riots were being there in Gujarat at that point of time, just by the three words which was spoken, which was purported to be spoken by this person. So the investigation department asked us whether these three words are being spoken by this particular person or not. Just only three words we need to compare, and we find out or we came out with the opinion that yes, actually these three words being spoken by this person. He was convicted after the opinion or the evidence which was being reported. Again, you people can relate with this, as most of you can are belonging to the Delhi state. You know that in Delhi, there are recently the riots or the menace which has been created by the farmer rally. And there was news that the police, Delhi police has fired on one of the farmer, and he died on the spot because of the firing of the Delhi police. After that, Delhi police come out with this CCTV footage, where the CCTV played an important role in finding out the truth that actually the Delhi police has not fired on the farmer. The farmer was overspeeded with the vehicle which he was driving, and he got crashed, or he met an accident due to the overspeeding of the vehicle, and he died on the spot. So this, as you see, that these kind of video images or video evidences plays a major role in identification of the truth. This I have added this case. This case was also been reported in Gujarat lab in year 2011. You might have come across with these news that there was a blast in the serial blast in 2011 in Mumbai, and there was one of the footage was been recovered from the Zaveri Bazaar, where the blast that was also one of the point of a serial blast in Mumbai. And that Zaveri Bazaar footage come out with an evidence in that. Fortunately, the investigators come out with footage where one of the scooter was standing in the market, and the scooter was actually considered as a carrier of the explosive material on that. On that scooter, there was a tiffin box, and that tiffin box was suspected containing the IED in that, which actually caused the blast at that time. So the question which was asked by the Mumbai investigation team to the DFS Gandhinagar was that whether we can identify the number, whether we can zoom into the number plate of the scooter, or we can identify the number plate of the scooter so that the origin of that scooter can be identified. But unfortunately, in this case, the problem was the footage which they recovered from the scene of crime of that CCTV, it was not of a better technical specification. The resolution power, the pixel size of that camera was very, very less, and due to which whenever we were zooming the footages get blurred, and the number plate was very, very difficult to be identified. Also, the distance between the camera and the scooter which was standing was also of a much higher distance, due to which the number plate was not being identified. Why I have added this case, although it was not although it does not give us with the positive results, but I added this thing is because we as a multimedia people, we can provide you the information which is already present in the footage. We cannot add anything. We cannot add anything new or something new in that, but we can extract or enhance the thing which is already present. But the most important thing is the actual specification of the devices which are being used. We can extract, we can enhance, but the final output will depend upon the actual quality of the cameras which are being installed at that particular places. So after this event, where after having 15 days of tremendous efforts of finding out the number plate of the scooter, we gave the opinion to the Mumbai police and the government that the CCTV cameras which you have installed in the public spaces or on the private spaces, they should contain at least a basic or a standard specification, so that it is not just for the monitoring purpose. If you want some type of investigation to be done from that, you need to have a better quality of the camera so that the enhancement can be better. So these measures or this kind of information was being sent or was being given from this particular case. So again, what we as a multimedia people can do, we receive most of the cases of CCTV footages where we are given with the blurred footage and we have to find out the number plate of the vehicle which is present in the footage. Number plate detection enhancement depends upon the camera quality and the actual orientation and the position of the vehicle. But if you get a better quality of the camera and the position is also fine and all the other environmental thing is also fine, we have lot many instrument to identify the truth or identify the actual number plate of the vehicle which is being present over here. We have n number of tools in our lab which are related to the video, audio authentication and the enhancement part and the comparison part that are being applied and can be, the pictures can be made in a much more better way. So this is a footage which we have taken from one of the case where there was an AMPED 5 software was being used. AMPED 5 is basically for the enhancement, we are using for the enhancement of the footages or the images. And the motion deblurring is a technique that is a highly technical thing. I will not go much into the detail of that, but this motion deblurring can be used for identification. These are the parameters or the algorithms which can be used for that. Identification or processing of the number plate for investigation. Again, the truth behind the scenes, you can see that this is a beautiful scene or having a mountains and the person who is roaming around the road. The picture appears to be simple by your visual naked eyes appearance, but actually there is something different in the picture. As you can see, there is a difference in this color variations or color volume of this two objects which are there in the pictures. We call them as a error level analysis. Why? Because this is a very interesting thing. Whenever you, in this case, this was the actual picture and this man was taken from some another picture and has been introduced in this picture over here to create such kind of fake or the edited images. We, whenever we use an instrument and we go with the error level analysis or the analysis of these kind of images, we find that because the two pictures are being taken from the two different devices, every device or every digital media have their own compression rates. So variation in the compression rates of the two different devices can produce a different color, as you can see over here. This is because of the different compression rate of the two pictures which are taken from the two different recording media. So this is basically to find out the actual truth, what is behind the picture, whether the picture is found to be a genuine picture or original one, or it is an edited image. This is only one of the parameter which is most easy for me to make you understand. There are many more. We can also go with the date and timestamp analysis. Whenever there is a digital file which has been created, there will be obviously there will be a creation date, modification date, or the manipulation date. That date and timestamp examination needs to be done or can be done to identify the authenticity or to determine the authenticity of the footages or the images or the audio files which you are having, whether there is any type of modification done in that or not. Next, so source identification, whether this picture is being taken from this particular mobile phone or not, is there is a parameter which we call it as PRNU, that is a photo response non-uniformity. As you know that most of the digital devices, they have the image sensors in that, and each of the image sensors have a photo site. So not every photo site or not every pixel which is containing a photo site will have the similar capacity of capturing exactly the same intensity of the particular white light which has been falling on that to capture the image and converting it into the electrical signals. So that difference in the sensitivity of each and every photo site which is present in each and every pixel of this image sensors, that gives a different pixel values to every image sensor which is being used by a particular device. And that difference in the pixel values of the image sensor which is present in a particular device which is capturing the image, the device identification can be done. So this is a very good source of identifying from where the image has actually been originated. So tampering in the e-documents, most commonly in most of the cases we come across, this is not actually the case. This we have created just to make you understand. Sometime what happen is you issue the mark sheet or you issue the case things where the names, photographs and the signatures are being manipulated or are being edited. There are the different techniques. We can do the metadata analysis also for identifying the digital fingerprints of the images or the evidence which are being created. You might all have heard about the word of hash value. Hash value is basically the digital signatures which are being created whenever any digital media is being formed or digital data has been created. Every data is having its hash value. Whenever you try to make a modification in that data or you try to change the data, the change in the hash value will be done. And that is the most important thing which will be useful in identification of the whether there is a difference or there is a modification in the data or the digital file or not. So the metadata analysis containing the different digital parameters or the digital fingerprints needs to be compared. We have DCT graph. I'll not go much into the detail because this is more technical things. This is a pixel values which we are calculating in the two pictures. Whenever we modify or manipulate the pictures, obviously there will be a difference in the color variations or the pixel variations will be there in the pictures. So that needs to be identified. The color variations can be done even in your normal photograph. You are taking a photograph and you are uploading it on Instagram. We have so many filters on the Instagram. If you enhance your photograph using those filters, obviously there will be a difference in the color value or the pattern. Even that enhancement is also being taken as a case of tampering, but that can be taken as a genuine tampering or the known tamperings. Tampering in the audio files will be done. Obviously, there will be different values or different parameters like histogram analysis. Histogram is basically the overview or the measure of the values which are there. And whenever you speak something, there are the values or the parameter like frequency, pitch, and the intensities are being generated, which creates a biodata of your voice. And those biodata of your voice is called as a histogram. And its histogram analysis will be helpful in identifying the truth behind the digital audio evidences. We have the break identification. Whenever you cut something or append something or add something in between, obviously there will be a lack of synchronization between the actual the voice waveforms that needs to be determined. Coding and codec frame analysis. This is basically whenever you record something on some particular device and you just transfer it on some another device and make the manipulations, that device identifications can be done. And sometimes there is a repeated sample, one sample taken again and again, same sample are being repeated or they are being appended. Most commonly we see it in the cases of the anonymous caller, where the caller record some voice of some maybe film actor or something, and again he is playing the same recording so that his identity cannot be revealed. So these repeated sample examination needs to be done. Coming to the legal admissibility, Section 65B as your of Indian Evidence Act, as you all know, contains the provision for acceptability of the electronic evidences. The audio, video and image or evidences also are being a part of such kind of laws, or they are being incorporated in that. And although this kind of field or the digital evidences still requires lot of authenticity analysis or lot of checking before accepting it as a evidence in the court of law, but now we are seeing that the court, because of the shift of the change in the pattern of the crime from the traditional crime to the technology based crime, the courts or the judiciaries are also accepting the digital evidences with a high ease to prove some case or to clear some investigation regarding the cases. These are the instruments which we are using in the labs of NFSU and DFS Gandhinagar. There are different softwares, the Goldwave computerized speech lab or the VoiceNet software for automatic comparison. These are for the these softwares we are using for the audio analysis. This is again for the audio analysis. We are using SIS system for the segregation and the waveform analysis. We are using SIDAR and the other instruments for the enhancement of the audio, because sometimes the audio, because in cases of forensic science, maximum time whenever you receive an audio file for comparison, it is highly degraded with the noise sample, the background noise, because of the recorder also, or because of the background also. So sometimes they needs to be enhanced. So enhancement purpose can be done with the help of this instrument. We have Acoustec for the comparison and the authentication of the audio file. Eddy Tracker is also there for the authentication purpose. We are using it. We are using it for reporting the cases for the Gujarat government and also for the government of India. For video, we have AMPED Authenticate. We have MIDAS for the CCTV footage analysis, and also we have different kind of other licensed version of the tools for the enhancement, authentication, and analysis of the video and the images. Thanks. Thank you all for being a patient listener and for being a wonderful audience. And I would like to thank Dr. Ranjit Singh and his team for giving me a privilege to share my knowledge on such a big platform. Thank you so much. Thank you.